This is the Bulldog, Eric Deters on Real Talk 1160. I left the station here last night at 10 p.m. TC was home in bed. Jacob, the videographer, was home in bed.
You assume.
What were you doing at 10 p.m., TC? It's a PG show, remember that.
No.
People are driving their kids to school right now.
I caught, I was listening to you actually around 9:30, between 9:30 and about 9:45. That was pretty close last night.
Was it radio superbity, or we called it political superbity last night?
Yeah, the guy from Chicago. See, I was listening
to
you.
Was that hilarious, that guy from Chicago?
How much did you pay that guy?
I didn't pay him anything. That was what's so awesome about it. The foreman of the American jury called in. That was incredible. I really enjoyed doing it. And guess what? This is later on at about 10:45, I called Rusty Humphrey's national show. They wanted somebody from Ohio to call in, and I did, and I gave him my analysis. I was bold. Virgil said fortune favors the bold. At 9:36 p.m. last night, I called Ohio for Mitt Romney. And I wasn't joking around. I was being serious. And I was the first talk show host, cable news guy in the country to call it for Romney. Now, the reason why I did that is I called a good friend and source who has a good friend and source within Ohio state politics that was involved, who knew which counties had not been counted yet, and they said that Mitt Romney was going to win. And I think Karl Rove indicated, I know on Fox News that he indicated that, by the way, this was not a Karl Rove connection, indicated that he thought, based upon the votes, that Romney would be okay. But I actually called him the winner. Now, how cool is that? National GOP election, and the political guy on Real Talk 1160, the little one, calls it for Romney at 9:36, and guess what? I was right.
Now, weren't you a little nervous, though? I mean, come on, because at one point, Rick Santorum, I think what they said, about a third of the votes were in, that Rick Santorum might have been ahead for just a minute. But there was that brief time between, I guess, like 9 and 9:30 maybe. I was hearing reports that
I was a little bit nervous when there was like 70% of the vote and he was still up by like 15,000.
Yeah.
My nervousness went away when 83% of the vote was in and it was down to 2,500 votes.
Oh, okay.
And then I said, here it comes. And, of course, he won by 12,000 votes. My source thought that Romney would win by 5,000. He won by 12,000. I'm going to get into all this today, and we're going to do, just like we did the other day, a different type of show. The Super Tuesday dominated the news, dominated the election, so we're going to focus on political coverage, and we are going to throw in the other matters that we cover here, like pop culture, sports. We're going to throw them in here and there as we go through. So we're going to cover everything this morning, but the focus is going to be, it needs to be, on Super Tuesday. I mean, it's just that simple. I have a great feel-good song for the day. We're going to cover everything. In fact, let's go ahead and do some of these. The quote of the day, anyone can carry his burden, however hard, until nightfall. Anyone can do his hard work, however hard, for one day. Anyone can live sweetly, patiently, lovingly, purely, till the sun goes down. And this is all that life really means. How profound. Robert Louis Stevenson. Jacob, I'm going to test my opinion about your generation right now and in front of you. Do you know what great work of literature Robert Louis Stevenson wrote?
I do not. You're probably right.
Good golly. In the defense of you, I know that my son and daughter would not know either. Erica would. He wrote Treasure Island. Robert Louis Stevenson wrote Treasure. Jacob did not know the answer. I wonder how old are you, Jacob?
23.
I wonder how many 16 to 23-year-olds know what great work of art from Robert Louis. I'll tell you who knew. The children from those good Catholic parochial schools in the tri-state would know.
All those contestants on Are You Smarter Than a Fifth Grader?
The honor students in the public high schools would know. Today in history, in 1845, Congress overrode a presidential veto for the first time. I'm sure the president was like, what do you do? What's going on? 1876, Bell received a patent for the telephone. Ding, ding, ding.
Really?
Yep. 1926, a great year here, day in history. The first successful transatlantic radio telephone conversation took place between New York and London. And in 1931, the Star Spangled Banner becomes the official anthem for our country. Famous birthdays. We have two funny ones. At least I think they're funny. Willard Scott is 77, and Tammy Faye Baker is 69.
Really? Come on.
That's no all. Comments. No comments.
Oh, all right.
69. By the way, how about the eyelashes?
Oh, they're 75.
Oh, my gosh. I mean, that face. Hello. When her and Jim Baker used to do those interviews, it'd be like, what am I looking at here? Proud to report, happy to report, no military deaths. Today's forecast, partly cloudy, high of 66. Tomorrow, thundershower, 62. Sun on Friday, high of 50. Jack Wagons of the day. Newt Gingrich for not leaving the race. All the Rush advertisers who are abandoning him. Oracles of the day. I don't know if you heard this story, but Christy Jeffords, the principal of Piner Elementary, and Terry Cox Curry, the superintendent of Kenton County. Now, I know this because Kenton County schools, the high schools, I think, get out like around 2:30. I think the middle schools do, too. The elementary schools get out at 3:30 because they start an hour later. They stagger the elementary and the high schools, okay? 3:30, school gets out at Piner. They're going to start loading the buses, right? Well, Terry Cox Curry and Christy Jeffords are doing their job. They're paying attention to the weather. At 3:35, they make the decision, we are not putting these kids on these school buses. Now, everybody knows that apparently the tornado that came, or tornadoes that came through Piner, I understand it was like 3.5 football fields wide coming through there. Now, you can imagine how many kids would have been hurt and or killed if there were buses out on Route 14 in Piner and all the side, Rich Road, all the roads in Piner. Can you imagine? But they were in there. They lost power. They were huddled in the hallways. But it's a concrete block school, and they kept them safe. You know, that's doing your job. You know, that's making the right call. You know, and it's so difficult because you're going to have that inconvenience. I'll guarantee you, no parent. I'd like to know if a parent complained. I'd like to know if I'll bet you there was one parent that complained.
You think so?
I just know how parents are.
Yeah.
But no parent should have complained.
Right.
They should be, thank you for keeping our... Because the I always say this about DUIs. I think the reason why people get DUIs is they don't want the inconvenience of coming back and getting their car the next day. Compare that to getting a DUI.
Right.
You know, the inconvenience of holding these kids a little bit as opposed to that. Now, the next oracle that we have is the first time I think I've given an oracle just for good luck. Louise White, 81 years old, of Rhode Island, won $336 million Powerball.
Wow.
81 years. You know, there's a sad, and I hope she lives to be 100. Isn't there a little sadness there? Now, I'm not trying to be greedy. You know, if I'm 81 and I win $336, that's great. Yeah. I get to give it all the kids. But you can't really enjoy it as much, can you, at 81 well, that you could true. If you. And
Is she single?
I don't know, TC, but if she is, she's getting lots of offers. Louise, you know, I've been looking at you for a long time.
So has TC.
My goodness. And then underdog of the day. I've been forgetting about the underdog of the day. And I made underdog of the day. Peyton Manning.
You think, huh?
You know what? Everybody, you know, he's had these back surgeries and everything else. I want Peyton Manning to go somewhere and win. And let me tell you, I coined this phrase. I told Rick the Brick this last night. And I told Nobody Likes Me this yesterday in a text message. I know somebody feels the Colts are getting old and they got to rebuild. And let's pick Andrew Luck and all that stuff. Let me tell you what losing Peyton Manning is. This is the Tony Perez decision of that franchise. And what is it worth to mess up the psyche of your franchise? And I say getting rid of Peyton Manning is a Tony Perez mistake. Just like the Reds did when they thought Tony would go. They'll tell you that after Tony left, they were like, man, we didn't realize what the heart and soul he was in that locker room.
Right.
So I think this is a Tony Perez mistake by the Colts.
You think they ought to pay him $28 million, though? Is that what I think he's worth, $28 million?
No, I tell you what you do with Peyton Manning. You sit down with him and you renegotiate it.
Okay. All right.
Now, there are those that say that they could still do that.
Yeah.
But I hear Miami calling. I hear Kansas City calling.
You know what? If he doesn't stay, I think he's going to Kansas City. That's where all the great quarterbacks go to retire.
You're right. He follows the Joe Montana. And, you know, Kansas City needs to win.
Yeah. Wouldn't that be nice?
I like the Chiefs, but they never win. When we come back, we're going to have some radio superbity. And as we coined it last night, political superbity on Real Talk 1160.
And make sure you join us later today at noon, Michael Savage, noon to 3 on Real Talk 1160. And now back to the Bulldog.
This is the Bulldog, Eric Deters, on Real Talk 1160. Little history story for you. Electricity was on everybody's mind in the 1740s, but not in a way we think about it today. People used electricity for magical tricks. Benjamin Franklin needed something to get close enough to the clouds to attract the lightning. He couldn't get up there since Philadelphia didn't have any hills or tall buildings. He did have a silk handkerchief, a couple of sticks, and some string. So instead of getting himself up near the lightning, he flew a kite up to get it, and it worked. Franklin and a few other scientists in Europe proved that lightning and electricity were the same thing. But that wasn't enough for Franklin. He believed that this knowledge should be used for practical purposes. What could be practical about lightning? Many folks knew what wasn't practical, having your house burned down because it was struck by lightning. Franklin thought he could help. He knew that lightning usually hit the highest part of a building. He also knew that the electrical current in lightning could start a fire. So he invented the lightning rod. A lightning rod is made of metal and is attached to the highest point in a house. The lightning hits the rod instead of the house, and the electrical current from the lightning goes into the ground and leaves the house undamaged. Franklin thought the lightning rod was his most important invention. How do you like that?
Really?
Not the potbelly stove.
Huh.
The lightning rod. Pretty simple invention, isn't it?
Yeah, it is. He was kind of out there, if you think about it, though, for the time.
This guy had to be, every day.
I wonder what would happen if if we'd have had electric sockets, he would have been the guy to stick his finger in one.
Right.
Of course, he would have discovered electricity first. You know, Ben Franklin would have been, if we'd have had MTV or cable back then, he would have been on Jackass.
Yes.
You know, because he would have done all those dumb stunts.
Yes, he would have. That's a good point. And humor, I got a lawyer joke for you.
Uh-oh.
This was texted to me by a member of Bulldog Nation. What's the ideal weight for a lawyer? Actually, this was apparently a joke told by Rick and Smokey. What's the ideal, but texted to me by a Bulldog Nation member. What's the ideal weight for a lawyer?
I don't know. What is the ideal weight?
3 pounds, including the urn.
Ooh. Ooh. Ow.
Ow.
That doesn't even get
a rough lawyer joke.
Yeah, it is.
Morbid, isn't it? Morbid.
Really?
You know what I'm going to start? You know what I'm going to start telling? I'm going to start telling Ace Hardware jokes. Get them back. Fat guy jokes.
How many Ace Hardware Rick and guys Smokey, take the
Rick,
light bulb?
Rick Smokey are so fat.
How fat are they?
When they sit around the house, they sit around the house. Oldie but goodie.
They have their own zip code.
Yep. Shakespeare, that's a good one. Shakespeare for your day. Now God be praised that to believing souls gives light and darkness, comfort and despair. Well, I give that to the tornado victims.
Yeah.
Comfort and despair. Dogs say today, yesterday I was a dog. Today I'm a dog. Tomorrow I'm probably still be a dog. There's so little hope for advancement. You know who said that?
No.
Snoopy.
That's pretty good. That's good. That is good. But it's like life is right now, isn't it?
Yes, it is.
Little hope for advancement.
Garth Brooks, TC, has joined the Country Hall of Fame.
All right.
And, of course, he gives us the theme song for Barack Obama, Shameless.
Well deserved.
Speaking of sports, we do have a little bit of sports. Got to do a little bit of sports. Peyton Manning, we already know he's parted ways with the Colts. This is incredible. Anthony Davis of the University of Kentucky was named the Sporting News National Player of the Year. 14.4 points, 9.8 rebounds, 4.7 blocks, 1.4 steals. 14 double-doubles, second nationally in field goal percentage, 661. leads the country with blocks. He is also the SEC Player of the Year, Freshman of the Year, Defensive Player of the Year. Calipari is the Coach of the Year, and Joe B. Hall goes into the College Hall of Fame. Big Blue Nation is going to be bragging big time. The Red Hawks, Charlie Coles, has announced his retirement from Miami. If you're wondering about who's in the NCAA already, here we go. Belmont, Creighton, Davidson, Harvard, Loyola, Maryland, Murray State, UNC Asheville, St. Mary's, VCU, and Western Kentucky, because they've won their conferences. Got a great story in general news today. And again, I'm knocking out all this stuff before we dive into politics. General news. Hackers. This is from the AP. I want to read this because I find this intriguing. The shadowy underworld of internet hackers was rocked by news Tuesday that one of the world's most wanted and most feared computer vandals has been an FBI informant for months and helped authorities build a case against five alleged comrades. I think it's funny they call them comrades. Use that Russian word, comrade. The FBI, TC, said it captured the legendary hacker known as Sabu last June, and he turned out to be Hector Xavier Monsecur, 28. Now get this. A self-taught, unemployed computer programmer living on welfare in public housing in New York.
Really?
The most feared hacker in the world is a self-taught, unemployed computer program. See what happens when you have too much time on your hands?
Yeah, good point. Good point.
Welfare and public housing.
Now, what would happen if a guy like that took his talents and his creativity and put it to good use?
Yeah, if a guy's that good, why would he be unemployed? Why
right.
should he be unemployed?
Exactly.
This guy could make millions a year.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Now, get this. His exploits made him a hero to some in cyberspace until he made a rookie mistake. He posted something online without cloaking his IP address or computer identity, and someone tipped off the FBI. Soon after his arrest, he pleaded guilty and began spilling secrets, leading to charges Tuesday against five people in Europe and the U.S., preventing more than 300 attacks. Hey, you know what I say to this guy? You know, it's catch a thief, you got to catch a thief. Like, Catch Me If You Can movie. You know how that guy really did help the government? He shortened his sentence by helping catch thieves. Well, by God, let's use this guy. Authorities said it marked the first time core members of the loosely organized worldwide hacking group Anonymous have been identified and charged in the U.S. This group was so fearful that prosecutors of these people have feared that they might go after them. I mean, I don't want to make these guys mad.
Right, right, right.
Anonymous, I don't have anything against you.
But how can these guys help us? Can you imagine the intelligence they have?
Oh, my God.
I mean, really?
Ugh.
What? I bet you they know more about Iran's nuclear program than we do.
They do.
You know, so why not? Let's make a deal, guys. You tell us what you know.
Let's make a deal. Absolutely. Yeah. It's worth it.
I think so.
You know, it's the old balancing act. Did you find that song from Mary Poppins for me?
Yes, give me a second. We'll get it.
Okay. We got to do a special. We had some special rest in pieces today. Congressman Donald Payne from New Jersey is a Democrat, age 77. We have the first rest in hell. First for us, new category, William Hirons, the lipstick killer. This is from the New York Times. The notorious lipstick killer who in 1946 confessed to three horrific murders in Chicago and spent the rest of his life, more than 65 years in prison, died at 83. TC, great example, 25 years or death sentence.
Yeah, you're right, 25 years.
When we come back, and he should got death sentence. When we come back, we're going to have a special tribute to Mary Poppins music, the feel-good song, and we're going to dive into Super Tuesday on Real Talk, 1160. This is the Bulldog, Eric Deters, on Real Talk, 1160. Having a great time here, about ready to dive into the Super Tuesday. We have a rest in peace for Robert Sherman. You know who Robert Sherman is? He was a descendant of General Sherman in the Civil War. I just made that up. Disney songwriter for Mary Poppins. I have to admit, Mary Poppins kind of scared me a little bit. But I had a crush on Julie Andrews as a little boy. And Dick Van Dyke, I thought was kind of a goofy dude. But I love the music from Mary Poppins. And my favorite song was not supercalifragilisticexpialidocious.
No?
Which I can say. It was A Spoonful of Sugar. This is not the feel-good song. This is just for Robert Sherman. I love that voice. Why did Julie Andrews show her boobs later in life? Why did she do that to herself? Yes, she did. I didn't understand why she did that.
I don't understand how I missed it.
The Gone with the, you know, not Sound of Music. Here we go. It does, doesn't it? Every morning I take that spoonful of sugar with a Coke.
They didn't know as much about diabetes back then. When
no,
this
they
song
didn't.
Was
they didn't know anything about diabetes. Yeah. Thank you for finding that. Now, I'm going to play the feel-good song twice today. And you know why? Because it's too darn funny. So, to get you in the mood for what's important in politics, as I dive in to my analysis of Super Tuesday, I'm going to give you a feel-good song to not only get you in a good mood, but to tell you what life is really about. You know what? If you want to know what life is really about, there's five songs. And I'm putting this on my blog in the newsletter, okay? Tom T. Hall, Old Dogs, Children, Watermelon Wine, I Love, I Like Beer, Fox on the Run, and this song, our feel-good song of the day. This is what life's all about, TC. Listen to this guy.
Oh, yeah.
Feel-good song. You'll be in a happy mood. Just listen to this guy. Old time. Paint the picture, Tom. My favorite line in any song. This is what the life's all about. Isn't it, TC?
More money.
More money. Listen to this. Listen to this. Tell us, Tom. Tell us. Telling it to us straight, that old guy is. Yeah, right. Yeah, right. Nice video, TC. Ho-hoo. More money. This guy looks like Jack Hodge, who used to run Century Construction. His son now does. I'll tell you a good story. He looks just like Jack Hodge.
That's a great tune.
One more reverse and we're out of here. But this is great stuff. So much for being a poet. Peace and comfort of reality. Older whiskey. Oh, I got it wrong. Wrong order, Bulldog.
Legal gaming.
Money.
Legal gaming in Kentucky.
Yeah, I got to tell you a funny story. Jack Hodge, I'm not kidding you, Tom T. Hall looked just like Jack Hodge. God bless his soul. He's parted ways. He owned Century Construction with Rue and Manjit. His son, John Hodge, now runs Century Construction. John and I went to Latin school together, and we in 1977, we went on the bike trip through Europe. Hodge and I were biking partners. And I would always, he was the lead. He'd kind of like set the pace and I'd follow. I biked behind John Hodge through Europe. And you know what's funny? We played basketball together. I never see the guy anymore. Really? He looks the same, acts the same. He's still the same. But,
well, give him a call up, you know?
Hey, John, if you're listening, call. Somebody will call. Hey, the Bulldog mentioned you, man.
Yeah.
All right, let's get into politics. Super Tuesday results. I've already bragged if you missed it. Earlier, imagine me bragging about something. I was the first talk show host and news authority in the country to call Ohio for Romney, and I did it when he was behind in the results at the time at 9:36 p.m. based on my source. Thank you, source. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. I called it for Romney. And guess what? I was right. And it was based upon Franklin, Cuyahoga, and Hamilton County not being part of the count at the time. And I knew. See, I don't have to live in Columbus and Cleveland to know that I'll guarantee you Romney ran those same bang, 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 bang Santorum ads that he was that we were watching here in Cincinnati. Romney won Ohio, Massachusetts, Vermont, Virginia, Alaska, and Idaho. In Idaho, they had a caucus where everybody had to bring a potato dish. Some people brought scalloped potatoes, some mashed, some baked, some hash browns, some potato cakes, you know, all kinds of French fries. You know, it was a potato caucus in Idaho. That's what they do. In Alaska, they bring their fishing poles, and they sit around and do some ice fishing.
and decide who's
going to win.
Ah, so you check, so you can determine the winner by their polls.
In Virginia, you have to dress up like Patrick Henry or Thomas Jefferson. In Vermont, it's Ethan Allen.
Of course.
Santorum won Oklahoma, Tennessee, and North Dakota. Woohoo! Newt won Georgia. All you Ron Paul fans out there, I'm sorry you didn't win anything last night. But they don't care. The delegates so far, here's the count. Romney 415, Santorum 176, Newt 105, Paul 47. The Ohio exit poll showed business experience is important. That's a good thing for Romney. Romney also is favored by women. National exit polls from all the, you know, all the states said beating Obama is the number one priority, and that favors Romney. What's next? We got Alabama and Mississippi, I think, on Tuesday. We got Kansas on next Saturday. Hawaii's in there somewhere, too. Ohio, in the number two congressional seat, Winstrup defeats Schmidt. Big
time.
That
coming.
Can you say super PAC? A super PAC got behind old Winstrup and just pounded, pounded, pounded. You know, it's just like anything. When Richard Nixon resigned, he said, I gave him the sword to run me through. You know, sometimes you just hand it to him. When she got in that ethical issue with the Turks, you know, where she took money for the from some a Turkish group in order to pay her legal fees. Trouble, trouble, trouble. Now, the morning after, let's do a little analysis. What do they get to argue to the American jury this morning? Well, here's what Romney gets to say. I won six states. I won Ohio, the one state you got to win to be president. And I picked up the most delegates, and I have more delegates than every single one of my opponents combined. I will beat Barack Obama. Now, here's what Santorum gets to say. I won three states in the heartland. I almost beat him in Ohio despite being outspent, God knows, 10-1. I finished second in lots of places. I wasn't even on the ballot in Virginia, and Newt and Romney won their home states. Excuse me. If Newt leaves the race, I can win. I also won the Ohio independent voters. I'm the best choice to be president, and if Newt Gingrich would get the hell out of the race, I'll win. Here's what Newt gets to say. Hey, I won Georgia. I won Georgia. Hey, I won Georgia. That's all Newt. By the way, we Jack Wagon Newt up. You know why? Because he needs to get the hell out of the race. And by the way, I was talking to my source, and I thought of this. This is another thing. You know, I can't believe. I'm sorry, folks. I give better insightful political analysis than you can see here on the national radio shows. No one has mentioned this. Newt has 105 delegates. Santorum has 176. You put those together, that's 281. You close the gap a little bit on Romney.
That's true.
What if Newt Gingrich says, okay, I'll get out of the race, and I'm going to give my delegates to Santorum?
I put a little spin on it.
Well, it would give it. And then going into Mississippi, going into Alabama, going in next week, you got the Newt support,
the
Santorum support. Because in Tennessee, exit poll, 73% said religion matters a lot or a little. That you don't get that in the Northeast. You don't get that way out West.
You know, I kept hearing, I was flipping around the dial last night between political suburbia and everybody else, and I kept hearing that Mitt Romney got the Catholic vote in Ohio.
Yes, he did.
Explain that to me.
Well, the reason why, and this is just reality, is the fact that your average Catholic, if they're a Catholic and they're a woman, they're still scared about the things that Rick Santorum is saying about contraception.
Oh.
In my humble opinion.
That's interesting.
And Catholics aren't the same as the Protestant voters. I'll explain that when we get back. Political superbity on Real Talk 1160.
Remember, if you can't get to a radio, you can listen to us live online at realtalk1160.com. Right now, let's get back to the Bulldog.
TC, you asked a interesting question. You know, Mitt Romney's being a Mormon, and he went in the Catholic vote. Santorum being a Catholic. Newt Gingrich being a Catholic in Ohio. But I think in this day and age, people don't get hung up on, okay, this guy is this faith, so I'm not going to vote for him because of that a lot. But here is something that people don't realize. Santorum may be Catholic, but he comes off very Pentecostal.
You think so?
Huh? Oh, yeah. I mean, you know, that's what I think. He comes off very Pentecostal. And I want to tell you something. Out in my, I use my community as an example.
Okay.
In Independence, Kentucky, St. Cecilia is a huge church. It's the biggest church out there. It is surrounded by Protestant, Baptist, Pentecostal churches.
Okay.
I'm telling you right now, they eyeball each other like, yeah, yeah. You're one of those Catholics from St. Cecilia. Oh, because we drink and have bingos and all. And the Catholics look at the Protestant, man, you act like you're talking tongues and all that crazy. I'm just telling you.
Oh.
Not everybody, but I'm telling you, there's a little bit. I mean, so the reality is I think Santorum comes off very Pentecostal, and I think the Catholics look at him and say, especially the women Catholics, and let's face it, the women Catholics do not want the government, they're against Obama, trying to force the church to, you know, provide contraceptives and insurance plans. Yeah. But at the same time, they're going to be taking their, they're going to be using their contraceptives.
But you know, I was talking to Rob Williams.
Rhythm, rhythm doesn't work very well, if you know what I mean, ladies.
Found that out the hard way, huh? I can't remember the lady's name now. That you know, was being called these unflattering names, was on The View. And she's not so much talking about, she's not advocating that women just be able to get contraception so they can have sex. But Rob was saying that what she's advocating is that there are a lot of women that for medical reasons, for health reasons, need contraception and can't afford it. It not necessarily for sex, just but for other different female type problems. So she's more of an advocate for that, and she thinks that people are losing sight of the real message that she's bringing there. It's really less to do about sex and more about medical conditions.
Well, I asked around, and the pill doesn't cost $3,000 a year. So it's got to be for something else.
Well, you know those medical costs.
I've got a couple other. I love original analysis. Reality check. Do you know, based upon the delegate count right now, Mitt Romney can win by May? Based upon the states that are to come.
Okay.
Santorum, even if he wanted to, he can't win until August now. He can't win until August. Ladies and gentlemen, the American jury, what do you think's best to beat Obama? To have Romney wrapped it up in May or Santorum wrapping it up in August? Easy answer.
Yeah.
May. I just want to let everybody know that. Now, here's something else that I am sick. And tired. Everybody loves that phrase I use. I'm sick and tired. He's so skinny I could use him for a whip. I love that line. But Republican enthusiasm. Oh, the Republicans. Well, 100,000 more Republicans voted in Ohio than 2008. But here's the point, folks. This is a civil war. This is sibling rivalry. I can tell you right now, TC, speaking from experience, when I was involved in a Republican primary, when I was involved in a fight with one of my brothers or sisters, you're doing it, but you hate it. The whole time you're fighting with your brother or sister, it's kind of like, I really shouldn't be fighting with my brother or sister. Yeah. When you're having a Republican primary, when I was the chairman of the party, it was like, God dang, I like both of these guys. This sucks. So it's a civil war. Nobody likes it. Nobody's going to get enthusiastic over fighting with your sibling. Yeah. Nobody's going to get excited over fighting with people of your own party. Ladies and gentlemen, the American jury, when we pick the nominee, I don't care if it's a dog, a cat, or a goat. We are going to get behind. I'm talking about we, the conservatives, the libertarians, the Republicans, the Tea Party, the establishment. It's all going to be, let's get Barack. You know what I'm saying?
That's, oh, yeah.
And you're going to see the enthusiasm. How do you get enthusiastic? Nobody points this out. I mean, all these political pundits on Fox News and Bill O'Reilly. How do you get excited over a civil war? You don't get excited over it.
And that could be the downfall for the Republican Party. If they don't do exactly what you said there, they'll be in trouble.
But they're going to do it.
Well, look at them so far. I mean, the mudslinging gun, you know.
I love analogies.
All right.
Here's a great example, TC. I got 10 brothers and sisters.
Okay.
All right. Let's say I once had an issue with Jed that we didn't talk for a year. And when I finally said, this is just terrible. It was a big relief off my shoulder. Okay. I'll guarantee you that during that time where I had like an issue with Jed, if I was somewhere, let's say I was at a restaurant and Jed was sitting on the other side of the table and I was sitting there and I saw some guy come up and start giving Jed lip, I would have went over there and kicked that guy's ass.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
Because as you know, if you got siblings, hey, I can fight with my brother, but don't you mess with my brother.
Nobody else. Right, right.
I rest my case. Isn't that a great analogy, a great metaphor? And that's what's going to happen with the Republican Party. And again, everybody says, well, God, look what all they're saying about each other. Look what all they're saying. Look at Hillary and Obama. Joe Biden is the vice presidential nominee, the vice president choice of Barack Obama. And during the primary, Biden made fun of Barack Obama for being like an inexperienced nobody. Mocked him, and he's his vice president. Because you know what they get to say, folks? And everybody accepts this. Rick Perry, Michelle Bachmann, Herman Cain, Santorum, Ron Paul, Newt Gingrich, whoever ran, John Huntsman. You know what they're going to say about Romney? Well, yeah, I said that about Mitt, but you know what? Mitt's much better than Barack Obama.
Yeah, yeah.
All right, Rush Advertisers, we're going to do this update every day. We ran the list yesterday. Now joining the departed on Rush, AccuQuote, Netflix, Capital One, and John Deere. I need to get my agent, got to pick up the phone and call Premier Networks and say, hey, if you need a replacement for Rush to get those advertisers back, the Bulldog's ready.
Hey, you know what? I have an idea.
Yes.
From now on, rather than call him by his name, which he stole off of a great rock band that has a song called Tom Sawyer.
I'm open. What should I call him?
Let's just call him the talk show host formerly known as, and leave it at that.
All right. That's going to be the talk show formerly known as having advertisers leave him left and right.
Yeah, yeah.
All right.
Well, so if you want, we can even call him the half-brain talk show host.
I don't want to call him half-brain. Let's call him. No. Let's call him the Vicodin guy.
Okay.
Remember his Vicodin issue?
Yeah. The prescription dope fiend.
I'm trying to be kind here. Usually I'm the nasty guy. The Vicodin guy's got some problems. What'd you call him?
The prescription drug dope fiend. Yeah.
You know what? That's a perfect example, folks. Why you don't throw stones on issues that can boomerang on you.
You know? Yeah.
I mean, if you notice, there's places that I will never criticize because I don't want anybody to say, Bulldog, you are a self-righteous SOB, and look, I mean, I'm just telling you.
Right, right.
And, you know, I just, but Rush Limbaugh, you know, when you think about it, because of that issue that he had, you would think, let me give you another one. That cable talk show host who is a big, loudmouth, bully Irishman.
Who, by the way,
does talking points. Am I allowed to mention his name?
Oh, yeah.
I want to know the rules here.
And we can talk about him because he's one of us. He's O'Reilly, on our team.
Bill O'Reilly settled a sexual harassment case.
Really?
Yeah, with a former staffer. And I think there was some guilt there. And he settled it. Now, do you ever hear him go after somebody on one of these? He never goes too far on those issues. Because I know Bill O'Reilly's sitting there thinking, man, I don't want to just open up that can of worms.
Right, right, right. Yeah. Now, he's a guy that, remember, you know, you probably had one of your siblings that would come up and just debug you. They'd put their finger in your face and go, I'm not touching you. I'm not touching you.
I know.
That's O'Reilly. That's what he'll go just so far without crossing that line.
You're right. You're right. And also, coming up at 8:35, we have Mike Huckabee Report.
Oh, yeah.
See, my show is getting so big that Bill O'Reilly and Mike Huckabee asked to have their talking points and their reports on my show. Thank you. Thank you very much. Obama, remember Shameless, man. He's always looking for the Wall Street boogeyman. He has, TC, his first national press conference of the year on Super Tuesday.
You know what? That was payback for that NFL thing back. Remember when the Republicans had? That's what right. That was.
That was payback for moving the Super Bowl. Listen to this. He said in his press conference, he's asked Eric Holder to examine whether speculation in the oil market is driving up oil prices. Are you kidding me? Eric Holder.
Iran.
I think it's Iran. I think it's your energy policies. Let's find the Wall Street boogeyman. Let's blame everything on Wall Street. You know what the immigration problem in this country is?
What's that?
Wall Street. We come back on Rip Talk 1160.
Wall Street.
This is the Bulldog, Eric Deters, on Real Talk 1160. We went into the break where Barack Obama has his first press conference yesterday of the year. And he also said, why would a sitting president running for re-election want gas prices so high? Are you kidding me?
Yeah, I kind of blew that one off. Are you kidding me? Come on. Yeah. I don't want higher gas prices.
He also said that, he's got Israel's back against Iran, but we shouldn't have too much war talk. How about Syria? John McCain is the only person in the Armed Services Committee that says, let's bomb Syria.
He does. And is he a grumpy old man?
He's
or
a grumpy
what?
Old man.
I mean, he's got
bitter.
I think he's a great patriot, but he has issues.
Bob Dole's bitter. John McCain, my good friend John Cain's bitter. Me and John McCain bitter. Bob Dole bitter. McCain bitter. Bob Dole.
And his little blue friend.
Has anybody seen a Bob Dole lately?
Nah.
I think he was starting to age. I think he's like, it was interesting how Reagan announced that he had Alzheimer's. He disappeared the landscape. They didn't want anybody to see him.
Right.
And I wouldn't want to be seen like that either. However, he gets into this gas prices. He says he wants Eric Holder to examine whether speculation in the oil market. How can he say that with his energy policy, with what's going on over in the Strait of Hormuz, and he wants to try to blame all Eric Holder. Look, anything happens, I'm going to have Eric Holder look into that. Illegal immigration. I think Wall Street's got something to do with that illegal immigration. You know, thanks to Wall Street, we don't have that wall closed up. You know, thanks to Wall Street, I had to submit a $1.3 trillion budget deficit. Thanks to Wall Street, think of another issue. We need some more Dodd-Frank laws. You know what? If it wasn't for Wall Street, we wouldn't need Obamacare.
We can't have a pipeline.
Can't have a pipeline because of Wall Street.
Yeah.
You know what? We might have to. You know what? The whole reason we were in Iraq and Afghanistan is Wall Street. I'm going to have Eric Holder look into that.
It's like talking to an effing Wall Street.
There you go. There you go.
But now, did we have a joke today? Oh, we did have. We had a good one today.
We had a good joke. I thought we were going to have this blonde ice joke, and I hope it's tomorrow. It's really, really good, but we didn't have it today. Another, I put in yesterday all the phrases that I just cannot stand. You know, like playing on the next level, flip-flop, all of that. I got another phrase that I'm just starting to crate on me. Jobs bill. What the hell is a jobs bill? You know what a job bill is? Any legislation that reduces, reforms our tax code, and reduces regulations. You know what? Congress doesn't say, we hereby pass a bill that says American corporations must hire 500,000 people this month. They act like, and they call it a jobs bill. They act like they create jobs. The only jobs they can create is hiring federal workers. And I went after, I'm going to do this again today. I went after George Will big time last night. I used the analogy of Eddie Murphy calling Richard Pryor complaining about Bill Cosby giving him a hard time. And Richard Pryor told Eddie Murphy to tell Bill Cosby to have a Coke and shut up. Well, I tell George Will to shut up and go to a Cubs game. George Will did this analysis about how none of the Republican candidates can win, and we really just need to focus on the Senate because the Senate is where, we can stop some of this stuff and slow things down. Hey, hello, George. We've got the House of Representatives. That's enough to stop legislation. Guess what, George? Why don't you pick up a constitutional law book and read a little bit about the executive branch's power? And you know what that power is, George Will, which we can't stop unless we win the presidency? regulations. Every executive branch, and by the way, I can name more than three. Oops. Department of Energy, Department of Commerce, Department of Health, the SEC, you name the department, the IRS. Those agencies can pass regulation after regulation after regulation, and Congress, your Senate, George Will, and the House of Representatives can't do a damn thing about it. Isn't that incredible? George Will, Mr. Conservative National Talk Show host, and you know what? How come, you know, now Donald Trump just basically goes after George Will personally, says he's overrated, which he is, but come on. You know, Donald Trump doesn't even know that. Gosh. Jacob, I'm the smartest man in political analysis in the country. Don't you forget it. Nobody mentions that. I don't get it. Let's go to some callers. Kevin, the foreman of the American jury, you're on Real Talk 1160.
How does it feel to be the inaugural first, whatever, Super Oracle.
Super Oracle. I tell you right now, it feels great, Kevin. I am the first person last night that had the Goheenies and the wisdom and the inside sources to call Ohio at 9:36 when nobody else called it till after 11 p.m.
See, the thing is, you said if. We knew it was in the bag, Bulldog. You said F. Come on, man. Get with the program.
I can tell you right now, it is fun. You know what? It's only appropriate that you, as the foreman of the American jury, award me Super Oracle status and a lifetime achievement of political superbity. It was nice to accept that award last night, Kevin. How can I exceed Super Oracle status? What's next for me? Well, how can I possibly achieve more?
Oracle of the universe, I would say.
Well, that's good. Do you got any political superbity, witty and wise for me this morning?
Oh, just picking up the pieces from last night, man. Did we have fun or what?
We had fun, Kevin. We had fun. Now, are you headed to Chicago, back from Chicago, away from Chicago?
Well, I'm in Indianapolis today. I'm taking a load to Hebron, Kentucky. And, yes, I'm off the side of the road. Don't worry about that.
I'm not worried about it. I text and drive all the time. My wife's ready to kill me.
Well, I can't even hold the phone up to my ear and drive. Not even that's legal now, man. So, you know, we gotta watch out for each other out here. You know what I mean?
I know what you mean. Well, Kevin, you have a wonderful day and keep on trucking. Keep on trucking. We have another caller. All these callers. John from Brooksville. 513-579-1160. John in Brooksville, you're on Real Talk 1160.
Yay, Bulldog. I think there's a couple good things come out of that election yesterday. Number one, the way Jeannie Schmidt got beat with them anti-Obama commercials, I think that's a good sign for us. And secondly, I think all these Republicans should start saying, isn't it great how these elections are going without any kind of bull crap? Because that's all we're going to see in November when these Democrats get involved. That's all I got to say.
Well, John, I can tell you this right now, is that Barack Obama and the Democrats are completely shameless with the things they do. I mean, let's start with them acting like the economy is proving when they submit a budget deficit for the year, their budget, $1.3 trillion, which is nearly three times the total market value of the largest corporation in the world, Apple Computer, which is total market value $500 billion. And they submit, I mean, are you kidding me? How does any common sense person vote for that? I'll tell you what, common sense people don't vote for that. They want to raise $1 billion to put television ads showing Barack Obama out there, you know, smiling and looking like, look at me, I'm a nice guy. Look at me, I'm a nice guy. Look, I got two sweet little girls here. Look at my shit, Michelle. Hey, let's do some jumping jacks together, Michelle. Show them that we're a fit couple. Yeah. Meanwhile, Michelle be just taking more trips. Gas price, you know. I agree with this, and it's, you know, it's like when October we had the meltdown. It was like John McCain's worst nightmare. There's an economic meltdown when he's running for president in October. Well, come September and October of this year, what's going to happen? Is there going to be some crisis that beats Obama, or is there going to be some crisis that reelects Obama? And as the president, you know, you can create some of those things. It's like, I think I need to show that I'm John Wayne. Who can I bomb to get that American war hawk to show that I'm tough?
How about Iran?
I know.
They're just sitting over there.
I know. It's like, how long do they wait? Go ahead, TC.
I was just curious, how do you think that would change the campaign if, for some reason, Israel does something between now and the election? And, of course, we got Israel's back, as we say. How's that going to change things for the election? What do you think?
I can tell you right now, you know, Barack Obama got elected with lots of interest groups, you know, 95% of the black vote. The Jewish vote is very much usually a Democrat vote.
Yeah.
And I'm telling you right now, they've abandoned him in droves. Remember that, I think it was Brooklyn Congressional District, or Queens won, where a Republican won in a very Democrat district that was kind of shocking.
Yeah, yeah.
And they weren't expecting that. And that was an Orthodox Jews there. And so I don't know. Now, I think him saying, oh, I got your back, I think he offended Netanyahu and the Israeli coalitions in this country, that I don't think he can win them back because I don't think they trust him anymore.
Yeah, Netanyahu seems a little standoffish now towards the president, you know?
Yeah, but you can't really blame him. Did you hear the story? Apparently that meeting last year, he kind of kept Netanyahu like waiting in a closet or something, you know? That's an extreme, but he kind of like wasn't very nice to Netanyahu, you know? Hey, wait here in the broom closet, Ben. I'll be right back. And then like not come back.
Yeah. And Netanyahu's like, what is this? What's going on, dude?
Yeah. We come back. I want to talk about the Dow in Europe. I'm going to have some fun on Real Talk 1160.
Make sure you listen for the Huckabee Report. That's coming up at 8:30 this morning here on Real Talk 1160. And now, back to the Bulldog.
This is Eric Deters, the Bulldog, on Real Talk 1160. Before we wrap up today, I'm going to give you a big laundry list of election results locally. We will do that. By the way, you can email me at eric@ericdeters.com. Any question, any message, any contribution. It could be a legal question if it involves Ohio. 47 days and counting in Kentucky. Also, in addition to that, you can text me, 859-250-2527. And also, if you text Bulldog to 42828, text Bulldog to 42828, you automatically sign up for my newsletter if you haven't already done so. And let me see, what else? Twitter, I am Bulllaw. If you want to follow me on Twitter, I am Bulllaw. The Dow. Now, ladies and gentlemen, the American jury, you know me to be straightforward. You know me to be straight up. I'm concise. By the way, I don't want to get into the details of the trial that I'm in over in federal. By the way, if you want to come watch, you're allowed to. It's open to public. I'm in a trial in Judge Spiegel's courtroom on the 8th floor of the federal courthouse in downtown Cincinnati. If you want to come in, check the Bulldog out the next couple days. Starts at 9:30 this morning. You're welcome to come. But like when I'm addressing a witness, I'm short, I'm concise, I get to the point. I scratch my head at these lawyers that like talk about all these things that are not relevant. I'm like, are you kidding me? They just go on and on. It's like if you got a trial involving, let's say, a car wreck case, okay? You know, there are so many issues that have no relevance to that, you know? Why ask questions about it? So this drives me nuts, the doubt. Yesterday, the Dow had the biggest drop of the year of 220 points. Now, here is what the national business financial analysts say to blame. It's Europe. Greece says that, they didn't want to take this deal. So guess what? Guess what's going to happen today? It'll probably go up. And you know the reason? Well, it looks like Greece am I going to take that deal, so there's no concern in Europe. What's going to happen on Thursday? It's going to go down. The reason? Well, Europe's still a concern. In other words, after the fact, it's like the football analyst that John Madden used to do. He used to crack me up. They run a sweep to the right. And they'll say, you see what they were doing here is they got the tight end on the strong side, and they pull the guard, and you see, they're going like this. Boy, what a great play. And he analyzes it after the fact. And that's what these financial analysts do. After the fact, they tell us why that happened. See, the Dow went down because of a concern in Europe. And then it goes up because the concern in Europe is taken care of. And it goes up and down, up and down, up and down. And they act like that they're experts in the financial markets. It's a bunch of poppycock. It drives me nuts. Why don't you ask one of the jackwagons, okay, what's it going to do? Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, go. They can't tell you. After the fact, they act like they're an expert and tell you why it happened. Am I not right here?
Yeah, yeah.
And in Europe, it's like, you know, Greece is, it's like, oh, we got a crisis, we got to save. I mean, how many, like, life-saving things do we have to do in Greece and France and Germany and Europe? Can you say every day? But I hate these pundits that, you know, last night, everybody's going to tell you why Romney, I called Ohio at 9:36. You know, these people that are afraid to make a choice or give you some analysis, which is proactive. Financial experts, they crack me up, TC. I can predict what's going to go in the stock market as much as anybody on Wall Street or these national financial analysts with common sense and logic, and I'd have the guts to call it before it happened.
Well, now, I'm sure that there has to be at least one or two people that say, you know, this is going to, they can call that ahead of time. There are some people that can predict that. Why, if they see a problem that is down the road like Greece, why not do something to
exactly.
Off, you know? You know that's going to be, it's been a problem.
That's a good point. Gold fell below 1,700. And all you gold speculators, the more gold goes down, the better. Because everybody knows that gold going up is an inflation hedge. And the whole idea of gold's also the economic disaster commodity. So, sorry for all you people that own gold. I hope gold keeps coming down.
What's hidden over there on the farm?
Well, Grant County, you know, I bought that so low. I mean, where I bought gold at $700 when I filled that barn up in Grant County,
yeah.
I bought it at $700 an ounce. So if gold, you know, it's $1,700, I'm still making a lot of money on my hold.
Oh,
you know, it's funny. I got to meet later after my trial today. I got to drive out there 6 o'clock to meet with the security people. There was some kind of glitch in the system.
Uh-oh.
You know, they say don't talk about religion. I had somebody text me. They said, be careful talking about that Pentecostal issue. Folks, what I stated was fact. I don't have anything against Mormons, Pentecostals, Baptists, Catholics, even Muslims. The reality is it, folks, is that there is some honest tension between certain groups. Protestant organizations, including Pentecostals, sometimes look a little eerie at Catholics because they drink, they gamble, they dance, they have bingos. It's just the reality of it. I'm not judging anybody.
Yeah.
Be careful about talking about Pentecostal. Are you kidding me?
Some dance with snakes.
If you're a snake worshiper, just be careful. Lehman Brothers emerges from bankruptcy. Now, they're the fraction of their own selves. I got a question. How would you like to be the vice president of marketing for Lehman Brothers? You know, you go bankrupt, you got all these lawsuits, you're coming out of bankruptcy, you still have these issues. We want you to go out there and get accounts. Yeah. Hi, Mr. Deters, my name is Bill from Lehman Brothers, and how would you like to take all of your gold and all of your money and invest with Lehman Brothers? Well, you know, I was kind of like, just maybe not, didn't y'all just come out of bankruptcy? I mean,
we finally got our act together.
That's a tough sell.
Yeah.
Now, I want to just say this. Let's talk about jack wagons in government. Hank Paulson, Mr. Goldman Sachs. And you know what? This has never come out. Nobody's ever talked about it or dug into this. What did Lehman Brothers, what was the little bee in the bonnet with Hank Paulson? Let's face it, folks. It was a colossal, colossal mistake that Hank Paulson made in letting Lehman Brothers go bankrupt. If you don't remember, Lehman Brothers was the first and only investment banking firm that Paulson just said, get ready to file bankruptcy, we're not saving you. And let's face it, the CEO fault of Lehman Brothers, a jack wagon, his own special elevator going all the way up so he didn't have to wait.
Yeah.
He was an egotistical jack wagon. But still, not bailing him out, set off a trigger. What it cost us in the long run, what triggered throughout Europe, throughout the United States, when they let Lehman Brothers, trillions, you know, you could have saved them for a few billion, and instead we suffer $1 trillion of damages. And nobody challenges Hank Paulson to a duel? I mean, Hank Paulson and Timothy Geithner, can you say, catastrophic bad call? And you watch, oh, God, God, this makes me so mad. I got this saying, you know, be a Marine, figure out how to get a problem solved. In that great docudrama where they lay out what happened, Barclays from London was interested in Lehman Brothers. And they had a little bit of concerns, and there was phone calls back and forth and everything else. And Hank Paulson just gave up and said, to hell with it. Do you think making sure Barclays would do the deal with Lehman Brothers was important enough, Hank, for you or Geithner or somebody to get on a freaking airplane and fly over and meet with Barclays yourself, the Treasury Secretary of the United States, sitting down with Barclays and say, listen, we really need you to do this deal because guess what? If we don't do this deal, it's going to set off some catastrophic things that are going to hurt you. It's going to hurt us. Let's figure out how we do this deal. No, he just accepts it. Barclays expresses some concern. So he gives up. And guess who ends up buying some of Lehman's bankrupt assets? Barclays. Ladies and gentlemen of the American jury, I only wish I could run our country. But I couldn't get elected a dog catcher because I offend too many people. Just like Rush. When we return, more political superbity on Real Talk 1160. Eric Deters, the Bulldog on Real Talk 1160. Let's give you the results of last night, if you have not heard them. Mitt Romney won Ohio, 453,927 votes to 441. Basically, 12,000 and some change. He beat Rick Santorum. By the way, Newt Gingrich, is how bad he is. He finished like fourth in most of the other states. He finished third in Ohio. U.S. House District Number 2, GOP primary. Brad Winstrup, 49% to Gene Smith, 43%. And that's why, you know, he won. U.S. House District 1, Democrats. Boy, it's like dead even. State House District 27, Peter Stoltenberg beat Tom Brinkman, 61% to 39%. On House District 29, GOP primary, Louis Blessing won with 63% of the vote. District 31, this was redistricted. This was the Democratic primary. Denise Driehaus wins with 58% of the vote. That's kicking some fanny right there. And I want to get to some other election results here. The county commissioner in Butler County, Chuck Furman, goes down to defeat. And it's a barn burner. T.C. Rogers, 35.6%, along with Courtney Combs. Courtney Combs is down 7 votes to T.C. Rogers.
That guy's dad's got a nice ring to it, doesn't it?
Yep.
All right.
T.C. Rogers. That's who we were for, right? T.C.
Oh, yeah.
We're for all T.C.'s.
I stole some of his campaign signs. Did I say that out loud?
Yeah, you're allowed to. Yeah, who cares? We'll call the sheriff, Richard, you know.
Yeah, he's our buddy now.
He's our buddy now. Claremont County prosecuting. We can rob banks in Butler County now. we're joking, folks. Somebody's going to go, oh, the Bulldogs, they're going to rob a bank. Claremont County prosecutor Vince Ferris takes down Don White, who's been the prosecutor forever. 52%. That's huge. Upset. Warren County, issue 2, Princeton City Schools tax levy. The levy passes 63%. Sorry, that guy from the other radio station. I support school levies.
Sometimes you have to.
I think there's nothing better than a local tax taking care of a local problem. And those voters can get behind it and help out their kids in school. Now, you got to hold the school districts accountable.
Right.
You got to make them do what they need to do. But to be against every school levy, yeah, no matter what, I mean, that's really narrow-minded, isn't it?
You're right.
We at Real Talk 1160 are not narrow-minded. Hamilton County, issue 9, Wyoming schools bond issue for the bond passes 73%.
Good for Wyoming.
Hamilton County, Forest Hills school tax levy passes 58%. That's right. Let's get it. You know, is there anything better? I'm sorry, folks. I fall for it. Is there anything better to spend money than the kids?
You got to, but the key is what you said. You have to hold the school districts accountable.
That's correct.
Because remember all those levies that failed with Cincinnati Public Schools back in the 90s?
Yep.
You got to hold them accountable.
Coming up after the next break is Dr. Kurtzman from Kurtzman Plastic Surgery for
Plastic
his Thursday report. I want to make a statement, And I apologize, ladies and gentlemen, the American jury, because you know, my microphone, my email address, everything we can do to help the tornado relief, we're here for you. We want to help you and do all of those things. You have to excuse me that I'm a man of pragmatic, how should I say? I'm just pragmatic. Bottom line is. Oh, we got a phone call. I'm going to take this caller. Got to take this caller. Brett in Independence, you're on Real Talk 1160. Say something witty or wise.
Talked about Eric Holder. It should be the job of the Federal Trade Commission to investigate these, you know, price gouging or speculation. It should be Holder's job to investigate them. And I don't think my whole life I've heard of the Federal Trade Commission doing anything.
You're right. And you know what, too, Brett? If you're a smart president, which obviously this president was smart, if there's one thing that you want is you want a buddy over at the Justice Department, and Eric Holder is Barack Obama's buddy. So he's not going to do anything that Barack – there's no independence whatsoever, the Justice Department, with Eric Holder over there. But don't you think it's hilarious that they want the Justice Department to investigate oil speculators for the gas prices when everybody in the country knows that the reason why the gas prices are is Barack Obama's own energy policies and the everything going on with Iran over in the Middle East?
Well, it's like Tweedledee and Tweedledum. It's about what it is over there.
Yeah, I agree, Brett. Thank you for that comment. I agree with you. What I was saying about the insurance claims is, sorry, folks, I'm a lawyer. Got to think like a lawyer. Insurance companies are not going to pay for anything they don't have to pay or that which they can claim they don't have to pay. You know what? I've been doing this for a living, okay? An insurance company doesn't say, well, you don't have coverage for that, but here, we're going to write you a check anyway. Never happens. And let me tell you something, folks. I brought this guy in. I got an insurance expert now in my law firm, and I did it because there's so many insurance claims out there. It's amazing to me what I have learned about how agents, TC, it's incredible, agents sometimes screw up in making sure you have the coverage that you expected and are supposed to have. You know, it's like, hey, you're supposed to have XYZ coverage. I want everybody to know that tornado coverage, storm damage coverage is a coverage that's going to be part and supposed to be part of every homeowner's policy. That's just a reality.
Yeah.
So if you got hit over there in Moscow and somewhere in Ohio, I'm telling you right now, There could be issues. And sorry, folks, I just know that. I'm going to tell you right now, that insurance adjuster who's adjusting your claim, you know what? He's not going to feel sorry for you that a tornado took off your, well, you didn't make that premium payment, so we're sorry.
Yeah, and then you got to deal with the types of insurance that you have. I mean,
right.
The replacement value.
Replacement value, exactly. Whether it's replacement value or whether it's a total value, total loss. You know, I mean, there's all kinds of issues. So I just want you to know out there, if you're somebody in Ohio that's getting banged on this, email me or text me. I'd be happy to help you because it's going to come up. I'm telling you, it's going to come up. It's going to happen.
And you would refer them to the right attorneys in Kentucky who can handle their situation.
I'm not allowed to talk about that. But you know what, though? The reality is insurance companies act like insurance companies. Yeah. Banks act like banks. You know, it's like a bank. You know, a bank doesn't say, well, you know, all right, we'll let you not make that payment. Sorry, when are you going to make that payment? I mean, they are just harsh.
Oh, yeah.
Harsh, harsh. That's why I don't feel sorry for them when they commit fraud.
Right.
When they don't pay. Here's a great example. A house burned down. $270,000 claim on a property house up in Ohio about a month ago. They were building a case. The insurance company was building a case against this guy. Not only deny the claim, but to prosecute him for arson. I got involved, said, hey, we're coming after you. They folded like a cheap lawn chair. And paid the claim.
Now, that should be illegal.
Yes, it is.
Here's an innocent guy who's going to job every day, and he's paying his mortgage,
lost
his insurance.
Everything to a fire.
And you're going to try and accuse this guy of arson?
Yes. And I'm telling you, they do that. Do you think adjusters sit down with those insurance companies at the end of the year? Wow, you've done a great job. Look at all the money you've paid out in these claims.
Right.
You've done a wonderful job paying out all this money. We're going to give you a raise. As opposed to this, Bill, good job. You've kept your claim payments down lower than ever.
Right.
Good job there, Bill. And how about this? You don't need a lawyer. We'll give you $500 for that, you know?
Yeah, right.
You don't want to get a lawyer. BS, man.
My brother does. He's a roofer. He'll fix that for you.
Exactly. I mean, I'm just warning you out there, Moscow, Ohio. I'm just warning you. If you got, and I got Indiana lawyers too. If you got an issue with, and by the way, it's going to start right now. You're going to start adjusting that claim, and I'm telling you right now, don't be surprised if your agent screwed up, your adjuster is trying to lowball you, because they're not going to pay something. In fact, my insurance expert told me something remarkable. He's remarkable, and he's been proving this true. He said, Eric, every adjuster is reading that policy to find out a way to deny it. I can find something in that policy to find out why they got to pay it. And every time I've had my guy take a look at the policy, he has shown why they need to pay the claim.
Wow. Well, that's good.
I mean, you're not kidding. And you know what? Who, including me, I'm a pretty smart guy, who reads insurance policies and understands them?
Good point. Only the person who wrote it.
Only insurance industry right. people know what the hell those are. And this guy is brilliant. I mean, my expert is brilliant, man. He reads those things. He'll say, now, Eric, you know, they need to pay it. I'm like, I don't even know what the hell he's talking about. Okay, fine. Yeah. You write it to me, and I'll write it to the insurance company. And you write that letter and say, you need to pay $8,000 more on this claim because of boom, boom, boom.
They realize, we got an expert looking at this.
The Plastic Man is coming up next. We'll see what he thinks about Super Tuesday, and we'll let him promote something like Botox or breast augmentation on Real Talk 1160.
And remember the other guy's sports show this afternoon from 5 to 7 here on Real Talk 1160. And now, back to the Bulldog.
This is the Bulldog, Eric Deters, on Real Talk 1160. You know what? Rick Santorum spent the night in Steubenville, but he woke up with a little pain, but he can still spin it. But enough of politics. Let's end the show on a informative note. Let's shift to a science part of our program. Joining me is Dr. Lawrence Kurtzman from the Kurtzman Plastic Surgery Group in Kenwood. Good morning, Plastic Man.
Good morning. What a change we'll have here from all this political talk. It's been a great political day yesterday, though.
Because a doctor won. Tell the ladies and gentlemen of the American jury how happy you are.
We love that. A good friend of mine, Dr. Brad Winstrup, with Wellington Orthopedics, a podiatrist, a war guy. He's been in the Army. He's been in Iraq. Beat Gene Schmidt. I'm very proud of him, very happy for him. He's a great guy. He'll do a great job in Washington.
If I was somebody running for political office, I would hate to run against a well-qualified woman, and I would hate to run against a veteran. I mean, it's just kind of like, how do you deal with that? But enough about that talk. You've brought some show and tells. Those people that want to watch the video cast, the last 10 minutes of my show, check it out. He has brought in some breast augmentation show and tells. Tell the ladies and gentlemen of the American jury by radio and video cast what you have brought with you today.
Well, I brought all different types of implants. There are several different types of implants. The major ones are silicone, which is the most commonly used one today. It's been around since the early 60s. It's very soft. It's very nice. This is the one that came off the market for about 15 years from 92 to 06 for a lot of reasons we can talk about. The other one is saline, which is just basically a salt water, which is obviously a
not as firm as the silicone.
Well, it's a little firmer. It doesn't feel quite as natural. The flow characteristics are different.
What about this one over here?
Yeah, this is actually for breast reconstruction.
I was going to say,
yeah, this is called a tissue expander. There's a valve in it here, and you can actually add fluid after it's in
place.
That's
a D. You're giving somebody double Ds with
that. Well, but remember, they're starting from nothing after a mastectomy.
Okay.
So it kind of depends how big they are.
Well, it seems like all of these would improve, you know, except this one. Maybe it's a C-cup.
Well, it depends where you start.
Okay.
You
know, that's true. What does a woman have to start with?
Right. It depends on her height and her weight and her chest size. A lot of different factors. You can't just say, is this a B? Is this a C? It's just where you want to end up. Then I pick the implant that gets them where they want to be.
Tell the ladies and gentlemen of the American jury about what breast augmentation is all about. What's it cost if you want to share that? Why some of the do it. Just tell the ladies and gentlemen of the American jury what it's all about.
Yeah, what it is, it's to enhance the breast. There's a lot of different reasons we do it. We talked about breast reconstruction after mastectomy, but there's also a lot of women that have some asymmetries. They may have an A on one side, a C on the other side, and we see some teenage girls with that problem where if you correct one side, they just feel a whole lot better about themselves. But there's a lot of different reasons for doing breast enhancement. Most of it is psychologic, to make them feel better about themselves. And that's about what plastic surgery is, to feel better about yourself. For a lot of, not only the reconstructive is to look normal, but the cosmetic is to feel better, to take something that's normal and make it look better.
You know, I look at it this way. That applies to everything. I mean, I'm talking about a guy losing weight, a guy working out, a woman dieting, working out. And let's face it, whether you like this, you know what? It's been proven, Doc, that taller men make more money and go further than shorter men. Same thing with women. More attractive, sorry folks, it's just been proven, attractive women can go further. The size of a woman's breasts has an impact on how they feel about themselves and their self-confidence. Now, by the way, some women don't care, which is fine. But a woman that does care and is self-conscious about it, thank God for Kurtzman plastic surgery.
Yeah, and that's the truth. Plastic surgery is not for everybody. Not everybody needs it. Not everybody wants it. But
I think Steve Jarnicki needs it.
Well, you know,
he's flat-chested.
Well, we actually do male pectoral implants, too.
Did you hear that, Jarnicki?
For some bodybuilders that work out, can't develop their pecs, they get implants, which looks very natural. And that's a different type of implant than this. I can bring that in next week if you'd like to look at that.
I'd be interested in that.
Seeing pecs.
I'd like to automatic, boom, look at them pecs.
Well, we do pecs, biceps, butt implants, calf implants.
Oh, my God.
We can bring in some stuff.
We can rebuild you.
Well, some of it started with people with polio where one leg would be very skinny just to try to make them symmetric. And that's what's nice about plastic surgery, not just cosmetic surgery, is we've done all this reconstructive surgery to make abnormal people look normal. What can you do with someone who's normal to make them look better?
I just thought of a business idea. How many breast augmentations are done a year?
A lot.
All right. Do you know, there's silicone, there's saline. Can we make a deal with you to be the spokesperson for green water being placed in breast implants?
Hey, I think we got an idea. I think we have an idea for next week's commercial.
We could get a grant for it because it's green, so the federal government would fund this and advocate, ladies, if you're going to get a breast augmentation, do it with green water.
Not the chunky green water.
Not the chunky green water.
The original green water.
The original. Yeah, I got to go with the original.
That's a great idea.
Do you not want to talk, because I know you want to hook them and get them in, do you not like, I mean, I'm just being honest here, do you not want to talk about prices for this?
Oh, I'll talk about anything you want. It ranges depending if it's silicone or saline. The silicone is more expensive, but you do get a lifetime warranty from the manufacturer. If you ever have an implant problem, you get free implants for life. I mean, it's a great deal. Anyway, it ranges
for life.
For life. Not the life of the implant, the life of the patient.
For life.
And you can't transfer it to other, like, house payments. Anyway, so the range is about $5,000 to $6,000 total for the implants, the surgery center, the anesthesia fee, and my
glad fee. My wife doesn't need it. Thank God it saves me $5,000.
Well, and again, it's not a need, it's a want. The psychologic changes for some of the things we do are just remarkable. I mean, you really can bring people out of their shell. You can make changes. You just make them more comfortable, quote-unquote, in their own skin. Some women won't get naked in the bedroom. They won't, you know, take off a T-shirt on the beach, a lot of different reasons.
I got a friend of mine that bought his girlfriend breast implants, and then she left him for another guy.
It's not an uncommon
thing. That's terrible. I don't think you know what? I think it's dangerous to buy your wife or girlfriend breast augmentation.
Well, it's something she desires, but they're
I'm just teasing.
Oh, I know. Well, I actually had a couple lawyer friends of mine, their wives got breast implants, and then they all got divorced. They put together a class action suit.
I got to ask you this. You know, I tell you right now, I'm lucky. Lawyers' wives and doctors' wives sometimes have too much time on their hands, so you got to be a little careful. I'm lucky. I got a good one. Now, I got to ask you this, Dr. Kurtzman. Who are your clientele that gets breast augmentation? Are they lawyers' wives, doctors' wives? Are they anybody and everybody? I mean,
well, it's not just lawyers and doctors' wives. It's a whole bunch of doctors and lawyers.
That's right.
That get
there
them
are
themselves.
Female doctors and there's female lawyers.
Absolutely.
Let's
very
not be sexist here, TC.
Exactly.
He's always wanting to talk about the women and not the men.
I'm sorry.
Well,
excuse
there
me, the men about the women.
And then we don't have to talk about it today. There are some men that get transgender people that get the implants also. But yeah, there's a lot of doctors.
Let's not talk
a lot
about
of
them.
We won't talk.
I did want to ask you something though, because the discussion came up, the debate about the issue. How do you feel about same-sex changes?
Same-sex?
Same-sex changes.
You mean opposite sex?
No, same-sex changes. That's a big debate now.
Change to what?
Like, you know, male to male.
What are they changing?
I just thought you had something.
I don't know. That's new. I think we're onto something there with green water, maybe. Anyway,
but green water.
But yeah, curve there. Sorry.
But you'd be amazed at some of the psychological changes for some of these women. And it's not like they become a different person. They just come out of their shell.
Well, here's something I know: women who have child, you know, after they have childbearing, sometime they lose their breasts.
They lose their breasts. They get droopy. Sometimes it's not just implants. Sometimes they need a lift also. And there's actually
a lift.
You know, and you see on TV shows that, you know, breasts are power. They actually had at the Republican National Convention once, they had a breast cam. I don't know if you ever saw that. They had a woman well enhanced who had a camera right in her cleavage, and they'd walk around and see how many people would stare down at her cleavage. It's almost
100%.
100% of the guys, for sure.
I got to ask you this about the breast implants and all of that. Do you notice from your own experience that it gives them self-confidence when they get the breast augmentation?
Yes. You know, their posture sometimes changes, what they wear changes, how they feel about themselves. You know, and it's not that they can't get men before. It's just that they have more confidence.
Is it covered by health insurance?
For breast reconstruction or breast asymmetry, it is. Otherwise,
but not elective surgery.
Not elective enhancement.
You got to save those pennies, save those dimes instead of buying a 409. Breast augmentation.
There you go. Do we have a song for this?
At Kurtzman Plastic Surgery.
We'll find one. We'll make one up.
I bet
what are
will.
Your hours of operation, doctor?
Every day I'm in the office Monday, Tuesday, Thursday, and Friday doing surgeries many days a week. Hours by appointment. They just got to call 513-891-4440, and we'll see you. This is the biggest time of year for breast enhancement, people getting ready for the summer, liposuction, tummy tucks, we do it all.
Eric Deters, the Bulldog, every dog has their day. Back tomorrow with Radio Superbity on Real Talk 1160.